Father, we are burdened that there's a world in deeply in need of the gospel. And Father, we pray that you might guide us and give us wisdom and how we might join Jesus on mission in the midst of this broken and hurting world, how we might make much of Jesus and point people to the cross so they might respond by grace and through faith to the good news of that gospel. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, welcome back. And we've been talking some about the cultural convulsion and acceleration. We've been talking about the great sword, and we've been talking about layers of engagement and disengagement. Let me come back by talking about, so we actually, this last fall, we hosted a reunion of the Jesus People movement. Now, depending upon how old you are, you would remember some of the bands that actually came together. So we reunited the Salt Company and Second Chapter of Acts and Nancy Honeytree, and you have to be of a certain age to know those folks. But some people, the people under 30, are like, I have no idea who you're talking about. Melody Green was there. Greg Laurie spoke. I spoke. Cheryl Broderson, who's Chuck Smith's daughter, spoke. Matt Chandler and I spoke. But what was interesting was kind of hearing from the older folks there, because we were going to do this. We did this big research project. You can find it at JesusPeopleMovement.com. We did an oral history of kind of the living remainders of the Jesus People movement. And what's interesting is, since we started the project in 2019, 7 of the 60 people we interviewed have since gone on to be with the Lord. So we wanted to capture their stories of how the Lord uniquely moved in the Jesus People movement. It was powerful. It was powerful. It was moving to me. But what I found interesting is how many people got up from Greg Laurie to Melody Green. They got up and they said, 2020 and 2021, 2022, we did it in 2021, feels like 1968 to us. And it's at that moment when the Lord broke through in this powerful move of God called the Jesus People Movement. So I want you to hear this. This is a really challenging time to be a pastor, and a member of the session, or an elder. But it's in challenging times like this that we often see the Lord use his people in such powerful and impactful ways. So I don't want you to be discouraged, but I do want you to be realistic. I don't think we're halfway through the cultural convulsion that we're in. Now, things do settle down, right? But they can get worse and have gotten worse before they got better. And so we've got to have reservoirs of resilience and community of support. Barna's research said that 38% of pastors are actively considering leaving the ministry right now. So that's a pretty stunning number. It was up from the year before by 10%. We don't know historically what the trends are look like, but here's the reality. We're going to need one another. We're going to need the EPC. We're going to need your presbytery, the community that's there. You're going to need one another on the journey. We're also going to need to love, care, and be patient with one another on the journey. So if we are indeed living at this time, how do we get to this great time of tumult and turbulence? Well, in 1968, what they said there was, this became a time, because the culture itself, all around us, people know it's not working. And I don't want inflation to go crazy. I mean, crazier. Too late to say I don't want to go crazy. I don't want an economic collapse. I don't want war. I don't want any of those things. But all of those things tend to really shake people at their core, and they're often accompanied by great spiritual renewal and spiritual outbreak. So if we're looking at a post-pandemic missiology, where do we go from here? And there's two kind of big themes that I want to talk about, because what for a lot of us, there were some implications of what took place in 2020. For a lot of people, we adopted almost all of you adopted a temporarily deficient ecclesiology in the emergency for the sake of the mission. Everyone said, we're going to do something, we're going to do different things. All of us did. We planned it out. But part of the challenge is that some of what happened was pastoral, but not theologically wise. Now, again, when I say these things, remember, because all of us get ramped up. And I know some of you think your church shouldn't have done this, or shouldn't have paused, or should have stopped sooner, or should have stayed longer. I know everyone has an opinion on this. But I'm actually not referring to that. I'm not referring to that. What I'm referring to is that pastors went into pastor mode. And pastor mode is, we got to make it okay for people. So we said, listen, the church isn't closed. It's just as good. We're going to be online, et cetera, et cetera. And in doing so, I think we persuaded some people that the physical proximate gathered community doesn't matter as much as it does. Now, some of you say, well, we should have never closed. I get that there are different views on that, and that's fine. What I'm actually talking about is not, because our church paused meeting, almost all of your churches did. Like I said, probably everyone here did. The question of when you came back. But my point is this, is that what we should have said, and what some did, is to say it is essential that we gather, but for this moment, we're going to adopt a temporarily deficient. This is not the way it's supposed to be. It's deficient. It's a temporarily deficient ecclesiology in the emergency for the sake of the mission. But I think now as we come out of this, there are two key things that I want to bring to you that I hope you'll receive in the spirit offered, that there are some paths forward, and then I want to get specifically how this looks like in evangelism. And they are two principles moving forward. I think we've got to elevate your ecclesiology and engage the mission. Elevate your ecclesiology and engage the mission. So let me start with elevate your ecclesiology, right? So regardless of how you articulated 2020, some people heard, and maybe you said it, right? I had pastors that I really love said it this way. You know, it's the church never closed. No, the church did close. There was something essential that was gone. And again, I'm not saying it was a bad thing to do that, and to, you know, I think it was appropriate to pause at different times in different places. But what I'm saying is that the best way to communicate would have been something essential will be paused for a season. But we need to actually, particularly now, I think ultimately one of the things we saw is the loose bonds of the church were let go and the strong bonds of social media held on. And I think ultimately we need to push back and create strong bonds of the church, because ultimately that is the body of Christ, the community of people who have been changed by the power of the gospel, who provoke one another to love and good deeds, the writer of Hebrews says, who literally hold one another accountable in covenant community. Okay, I mean, where else are people gonna be held? This is a countercultural value. So I do believe that true, full biblical community requires feet and faces, not just electrons and avatars. Now again, I'm not against electrons and avatars. I think it's good to have additional tools. But for some people, coming out of COVID, they got so excited about the online that they've made it a goal. It's not a good goal, it's a good tool. The goal should be people in community, proximate and physical. But again, there are exceptions out there, persons with disabilities, there are lots of exceptions to that. But that being said, I think we've got to elevate our ecclesiology. And if I was picking a series this summer, I would be teaching some, we already picked our series this summer, but I'd be teaching some on what the church is, why it matters, and why we need to prioritize it in our lives. And the second thing is, principle coming out of this, and this is where I'm gonna spend the rest of my time, is to engage the mission. So remember the front third, several of you at the break said that made sense to you, and that was encouraging. So the front third, the middle third, and the back third is a key thing I like to kind of use and articulate. And by the way, too, let me also say, too, that you've probably got some new people. You got a new third in the midst of that as well. When I preached at Saddleback and I explained, we had a graph. We're part of the COVID church tracking attendance research project. And pastors tell us that there's a lot of new people in their churches, and 30% of them, according to pastors, came from their last church where they disagreed with their last church's approach to COVID. Isn't that interesting? So a third of the people. And my guess is people left your church over that, went somebody else's church, and people are at your church who came from somebody else's church as well. So a third, a third, a third. So here's what I want you to hear. That front third, I think, is a key moment for us. They got it, right? They're serving more and giving more. They stepped up. They stood out. They stood in the gap. They're showing the shared love of Jesus. My church has a higher percentage of people serving and sharing, and that front third than ever before. The middle third is sort of hanging on, waiting, still trying to see how, you know, it's been a hard few years. The back third disconnected potentially permanently. But here's what I want to say. When it comes to engage the mission, I think that what we can do now, what I'm working towards, I'm a teaching pastor at my church, so I don't set the preaching calendar, but I speak into it. What I've encouraged our church to do is to really work hard so that we normalize the front third. In other words, what's kind of normal is the second third. There's a few people who are like super involved, but most people sort of come as consumers. They're consumers of the religious goods and services distributed by the church. And if you do it well, they like you, they come back, they like the music, they like the children's program, they like it. So we are creating customers of religious goods and services distributed at our church, okay? That's not what we want. Well, this disruption has disrupted that pattern. right? So the reality is the front third stepped up, stood out, and stood in the gap. I want to say to the front third, let's get the second third to look more like you and your engagement. So actually what I'm encouraging church to do is to get the front third to engage with the second third so we raise the level of engagement and involvement. Then this fall, which is a time when I think people will begin, I don't think they're coming back at the level they were before, but if we can use this fall to reach out to, it's harder to do that in summertime depending on your geography, but this fall to reach out to the back third, which could be more than the first and second third put together because they're so infrequent attenders, and then all of us together to reach the world. But I want to, here's what I want you not to hear. I've spent the last 20 years writing about the missional church and doing podcasts and articles, angsty articles about how we've got to get people not to think of themselves as customers of religious goods and services. And in the last 2 years, a whole lot of that front third have become co-laborers in the gospel. Let's normalize that. And not, matter of fact, people say to me, what are you afraid is going to change forever? The big thing I'm actually afraid is we're actually going to go back to the way it was before, where people kind of thought of the church as this place that was there to provide and care for them solely. I think there's a place for pastoral care. I'm very pro-pastoral care. So engage the mission means that we're going to be showing and sharing the love of Jesus in powerful and impactful ways. So how might we do that? Well, many of you flew here, and you actually made it if you're here, which not everyone has made it to their flights lately. But what you find is you get on a plane from Chicago to LA, and they'll say, you know, it's going to be 3 hours, and we're going to get there early because we've got some great tailwinds. Now, tailwinds are winds that are behind. Typically, it wouldn't be going that direction. It would be headwinds that direction. But let me start with there. So headwinds are winds that are blowing at your plane, and the jet stream blowing, and it slows you down. So headwinds slow you down. Tailwinds are propelling you forward. So I think that we're right now in a season, if we're going to focus on evangelism, we have certain headwinds and tailwinds that we have to address. So remember, elevate your ecclesiology, engage the mission. The mission includes both sharing and showing the love of Jesus. I believe in both. I wrote a book on showing the love of Jesus called Subversive Kingdom. But I'm going to talk about here about sharing, because that's primarily where they wanted me to focus here, about sharing the good news of the gospel, something we're deeply passionate about at the Wheaton College Billy Graham Center. I'm a first-generation convert in my family. Most of my family are not Christians. And when I say they're not Christians, I don't mean they're in a denomination that I don't like. I mean they don't say that they're Christians. You have to sometimes be clear among people that I'm not talking about those denominations, just they're not believers. So I'm deeply concerned that we seem to be at a season when evangelism, the only time people are talking about evangelism nowadays is when they're making fun of how people used to do it. And I would say something D.L. Moody once said, I like my way of doing evangelism better than your way of not doing evangelism. So this really matters to me. You know, when I serve at the Wheaton College Billy Graham Center, and I was the interim pastor of the Moody Church, both named after evangelists, this deeply matters to me. Now, the cultural moment matters to me because it impacts us. So I'm a missiologist. My PhD's in mission. Missions is understanding people before you tell them, but missions is deeply tied to evangelism, which is telling them. So I've tried to help you understand the cultural moment as best I could in the short time that we had, and now I want to talk about telling them in the midst of the cultural moment. So let's first look at some of the headwinds coming out of COVID. Headwinds coming out of COVID. One of them I've already talked about. I didn't call it this, but it's called shrinking nominalism. So I don't know if you saw, but now we're down to 81% of Americans, just this last week, 81% of Americans believe in God. It's declining precipitously. The percentage of people who are Christian is declining, who call themselves Christian, is declining 1 to 2% per year. So what's happening is the percentage of people who are devoutly religious in this country actually has remained relatively steady. You got to listen to my keywords, devoutly religious. So it has remained relatively steady for a few decades, right? So that would include it's now mostly evangelicals. More than half of the devoutly religious people in the country are evangelicals, but that includes Catholics, that includes Mormons, that includes people of other religions as well. And again, to be clear, I'm not making a theological statement, I'm saying they're devoutly religious. So that has not declined precipitously. What's declining precipitously is people who are a little bit religious, or use the word Christian to describe and define themselves, and it's not that important to them. They are dropping the label like crazy. But not only are they dropping the label, they're dropping their openness to the conversation to some level. Now, still, the majority, I'm going to show you, there's a lot of openness still that's there, but nominalism, people are Christians in name only. Most of our evangelistic outreach is geared towards people who already say that they're Christians. Now, that's a very strange thing. I was actually talking to a Jewish religion reporter, and she said to me, she said, you know, like, I forget the time, she's like, 75% of Americans are Christians. Why do you Christians always sound like there's so few of you? And I said to her, I said, well, we actually don't believe that they're all Christians. And she said, well, if they said they're all Jewish, I'd believe them. Why don't you believe them? It's a fair thing. And I remember explaining and how strange it sounded coming out of our mouth. So I said, well, a big part of evangelism is convincing people who think they're Christians that they're not actually Christians so they can become Christians. And she said, really? I said, yeah. And you know it's true, right? Most of the people that you have seen come to Christ in your church the last 10 years are people who already used the word Christian to describe themselves before they were. If they filled out a form, they say the word Christian on it. So that percentage is shrinking, and what's replacing it is people of other religions or people who are secular, not generally atheists. So there's certainly atheism is a growing thing. But here's the weird thing. Most people who don't believe in God don't call themselves atheists. Interesting, because people don't like atheists. I mean, statistically. I'm not saying you don't have to. I'm just saying statistically, it's like people didn't like, if you do polls, people don't like them. So a lot of people will kind of stay away from that label. But the reality is we're going to have a harder time sharing the gospel. And this is why I was very enthusiastic about your engaging the three circles. So Jimmy Scroggins has been a dear friend for a long time, done things at his church. And I think the three circles helps to frame the conversation in a way that we didn't have to. So when I came to Christ, I got in trouble as a teenager, as a youth group age kid. And my mother, who was a brand new believer, punished me by sending me to youth camp, which I will tell you, if you're a youth pastor, that's really what you want, is a bunch of kids who got grounded and had to go to youth camp. Because nothing says it's going to be a great week than a bunch of people who this is their punishment. So my mother sent me to this camp. But I heard the gospel there, and I responded by grace and through faith. I was born again that day, little youth camp. I took my daughter to there just to see. I said, Caitlin, that's right. That's where I trusted Jesus. And they said, the first thing you, I still remember the person who it was a band, and First Love was the name of the band. You never heard of it. It was just a little local church thing. And then they said, you should go home and tell someone who's not a Christian that you've become a Christian. And that's really a great practice, by the way, because what it does is it cements evangelism early on. But I didn't know the words, I didn't know language. So I went home to my dad and I said, Dad, are you saved? And that's the word they use. Now I'm saved, I'm born again. So I said, Dad, are you saved? And my dad said, saved from what? And I said, I have no idea, but I just was, and you need to be. That was my first evangelistic encounter. Now, where I grew up on Long Island, and we were nominally Catholic. The Catholic Church was the church we didn't go to on Sundays. But I knew God wrote a book. I just didn't think I could understand it. I knew that there was a God, I just didn't think I could know him personally. And when someone told me, I was ready to go from, okay, wait, so the Bible says that I'm a sinner and I'm in need of God's grace. It's right there in the Bible. I have respect for the Bible. I've seen the priest hold the Bible or read from the Bible. It says Jesus says I need to be born again. Okay, I want to listen to Jesus. And so, but here's the thing, all of the predecessor facts there, all that pre-existing information, doesn't exist for people who aren't nominal Christians, and increasingly doesn't exist for people who are nominal Christians. So as we enter into more of a secular age, a post-Christendom age, it's harder because, I mean, I even see some of our evangelism training, which is basically telling people, you know, you can be born again. Well, what does it even mean to be born again? What does it mean? So for my family, most of the issue for them is not that they think God is good, is they don't understand why Jesus had to die on the cross for their sin and in their place, and they have to receive by grace and through faith his work on the cross on their behalf through his resurrection and victory over sin, death, and hell and the grave. So again, people are starting a different place, and nominalism is a key. The shrinking percentage of nominalism is a big thing, but that's not the only one. Let's keep walking through shrinking nominalism, and we go from there to attitude towards proselytizing. So proselytizing is the generic word. We use the word evangelism, but evangelism is a Christian word, evangel, even though the business world has adopted evangelism, by the way. You know, Apple has an evangelist. Starbucks has an evangelist. They actually hire evangelists. There's titles in their name called evangelists, which I think is fascinating because I think a lot of, if you've gone back 30 years ago, some of the people in the church have all moved away from the term evangelist. partly because of the language, but the world has adopted that term. Maybe we need to remind ourselves that the good news of the gospel being shared. You're the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, and the heart of that is the evangel, the good news of the gospel. So let me just say, too, as someone who works at the Billy Graham Center, used to be the interim at Moody Church, I once got in front of Moody Church, and I said, listen, we got to up our evangelism. We got to either change our name or change our ways. Let me tell you, as Evangelical Presbyterian Church, the evangel being at the core of what you do, you've got to make sure that that value is reflected. That name matters, and I recognize that name has some baggage. We're going to specifically talk about that in a minute. But evangelism has fallen on hard times. People are okay with you being religious. It's you trying to encourage them to switch religions or to become religious, using the term that they might use, is the problem. People are anti-proselytization. They're anti-evangelism in this age. Accelerating cultural shifts, right? So we are now, by the world standard, on the wrong side of a lot of cultural issues by the world standard. So it's not just that. Now, mind you, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, that wasn't the case. But today, we find ourselves on the other side of the cultural divide, particularly from people who are not Christians, because it's only a smaller and smaller percentage of people. And there's cost to that, right? So I don't know if they have repealed Roe v. Wade, not, I've been with you, but I'm not sure if it's released today. But you'll see my article in USA Today, what it means now, being thankful. I was speaking with gratitude of the repeal of Roe v. Wade and the work that we have to do moving forward as followers of Jesus. I know a lot of people who don't follow Jesus are going to be bothered by that. And we walk kind of a tricky line, right? So accelerating cultural shifts puts us on, from the people from the world standards, the world side, but we need to speak up for what's right. And in this case, it's the unborn. We need to speak up for what's right on other issues as well. So it becomes a challenge. How do you do that? I'm going to talk about how to, because there's some tailwinds that are going to help us. The fourth headwind is the image of evangelicalism. The image of evangelicalism. Again, you're the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. And I know that you've had people in your church or in your community say, is evangelical the right word to describe ourselves? It's been a tricky time. It's been a tricky time because, and some of it's because of things evangelicals have done or maybe who we are. Some of it's because of an unfair presentation of who we are in multiple contexts. It's a mix of all of those things. But here's the thing. At the end of the day, Christians have had bad reputations on and off for 2,000 years, and the gospel is still advanced. Now, the reality is you might find that there are places that that you're not invited. You might find relationships that are difficult to maintain. But this is where our fidelity and faithfulness to the gospel is necessary in the midst of this. But also, too, we should address some of the issues inside of our movement as well. I've tried to do that. You may not always agree with the ways that I've done, but I've tried to do that as well. So one of the things I want to let you know about, too, is we actually think that this moment we're in, one way through is, I think there are two main ways through. Point people to Jesus and help people to really rightly see Jesus followers. Because my guess is your neighbor, let's say you got a neighbor who's really anti-Christian. They're probably not anti you. I mean, unless you've been a bad neighbor. But my guess is they barred your lawnmower and you built some sort of relationship, things of that sort. So it's like in my case, I have a congressman. My congressman in my district is part of the coalition that wants to defund Christian colleges, you know, so very much different than me on all major social issues. And yet I've befriended him. We're friends. And in the midst of that, he'll say, well, you're not like so-and-so. So I said, you know, I believe the same thing that they believe. I said, we don't seem angry about it all the time. And what I said, I don't think they're as angry as you think they are. I think you're reading into some of those things. So what happens is, I think pointing people to Jesus and seeing individual relationships with Christians is going to be key. It might be harder to invite them to church because the church's reputation may suffer, but pointing people to Jesus and more. So I'm actually, I'll give you a little backstory. Some Christian business leaders have actually decided that they want to help start and foster a conversation about who Jesus is, pointing people to Jesus, and then hopefully their Christian friends will continue the conversation with them. And there have been ads. It's the largest faith-based media campaign in history. Some of you remember the Mormons did this thing, I'm a Mormon, and millions of dollars. And the Methodists did this thing, you open hearts and open minds and millions of dollars. But never has an evangelical group done that, because who does it? Like, is it, you know, does the EPC do this, or does the you know, Assemblies of God or the Southern Baptists do this? Well, some business leaders said, we're going to put $150 million a year into getting a conversation started about Jesus. And that's this is called He Gets Us. And this, I'm one of the national spokesperson. And it's all these ads. I just had a interest. How many of you have seen a He Gets Us ad? Oh yeah, okay, lots of you, okay. So, and I'm actually too, I'm working with some of your leaders. We may do a briefing on this, because the business leaders got way ahead of the Christian ecosystem, and in the sense, and not in a bad sense, but in the sense that they were decided about it, they started running ads, and now we're trying to help churches sort of catch up and create strategies around this, because people are talking about Jesus. Here's why.
There was an influencer who became insanely popular. Everybody started following him. Then, one day, he stood up for something he believed in. People got angry. The establishment called him an extremist, said he shouldn't be allowed to share his views. They would stop at nothing to shut him up. So they did what they had to do. They nailed him to a cross.
What we found in our research is that the vast majority of Americans, even those who don't go to church, even those who are hostile to church, tend to have a positive impression or perception of Jesus. Now, don't miss this. We all know they make Jesus in their own image. Everybody makes Jesus in their own image. We need to get, but here's the thing. If I'm right, that key pointing forward is going to be pointing people to Jesus and to Christians. Those Christians, if trained and engaged, can help foster conversations around the water cooler or in the homeowners association and more. So people are talking about, how does Jesus get us? How do we understand Jesus? Well, guess what? Jesus came, died on the cross for our sin. Point them to the good news of the gospel with Christians who love and care for them as well. This is a tailwind. Right now, we have Christian business leaders who, without anybody's permission, went ahead and decided to invest hundreds of millions of dollars to get people talking about Jesus. Let's go. So, because some of you are old enough to remember, because I still remember this. So my family's not a Christian, mostly not Christian. I remember making fun of the last time there was a big campaign like this, and it was, I Found It. How many old enough to remember Campus Crusades, I Found It? Yeah, sure. So like we were non-Christians, and my dad had this funny line, because there were these bumper stickers all over in New York, said, I found it. And my dad, like, well, I found it, and I got it all over my shirt. And for some reason, I just remember that. So I literally remember, but here's the difference. There was nobody to tell us what it meant. Well, here with He Gets Us, there's a website. If you go to hegetsus.com, that's non-Christian facing. Hegetsuspartners.com, that's more you facing. But there are tailwinds, and one of them is this great spiritual hunger. I've sensed like I've never sensed before. I was actually talking to Matt Chandler. He's a student in one of our programs, in our grad program at Wheaton, finishing his master's degree. And we were just talking. He said, Ed, I've never seen more spiritually hungry people who've looked at the world, said, the world has failed. I need something eternal. And I see that all over the place. I see that when my kids bring their friends over. I see that in the next generation, which I'm going to unpack some in just a minute. I see that in the next generation. And where they're in broken homes and fatherless and unsure about the future, and COVID's taken such a toll. And I've had the privilege to sit down and pray with them and share the good news of the gospel with them. There's a spiritual hunger that's out there. The world's on fire, and it's an opportunity for us to show and share the love of Jesus. The failure of the modern experiment, I've already touched on this, but it's not working, sisters and brothers. The world, the center, is not holding. If 10 years ago you thought we're just going to keep going, things are going to get better and better and better, it's not. And I think that points people to the reality of the deep need of Jesus. I think the deployment for mission. I love the fact that right now, the front 30 of your church is more engaged and more involved. I wouldn't have thought that 2 years ago. But they've stepped up, they stepped out, they stood in the gap, and it's an opportunity for us to invite them. And I think the tumult and the opportunity that we have before us is obvious. The tumult that we have before us is obvious. It's tumult and opportunity. Again, if we're living through a cultural convulsion, in 1968, we got the Jesus People movement. Last time happened before that was late 1800s, and we got the Pentecostal movement, right? So Pentecostal movement kind of bubbles out the Welsh revival, and the Pentecostal movement sort of bubbles out of the cultural convulsion of the late 1800s. We can point to the Second Great Awakening related to the cultural convulsion of the mid-1800s. I mean, over and over again, but it's not going to be easy. We're going to need each other, support communities. We're going to need reservoirs of resilience. If you as a pastor or church leader find yourself struggling and unable to push through some of these, it might be time to say, let's support one another with mental health community options as well. We can find that path forward. Again, I love the phrase in Esther 4:14, perhaps you've come to this role, to this position for such a time as this. So where do we go from here? How do we engage the next generation? You can see Gen X, Millennial, and Gen Z are two generations that we're talking about here. My friend Rick Richardson wrote a book called You Found Me, looking about how we were engaging younger generations. And these numbers have actually shifted some since the book was out, but let me share with you some quick takes on Gen Z, because I talked about sex and gender. Let's take a look. In Gen Z, 16%, now it's actually up to 20, over 20 now, 16% identify as LGBT, 59% say application forms ought to have more gender options than man or woman, and 28% by age 17 have experienced sexual abuse. It's a very different world than particularly those of you who grew up in a church world and a church context. And as the father of Gen Zs, you can actually see and walk through with some of the Christian kids, I'm not sure how to respond to this, and I don't think the generation before me has given me the tools or the knowledge or even has the understanding of how to help me to respond. So I want to encourage you to acknowledge, we can talk about 50 other subjects, I'm just touching on a few key issues. I really want to encourage you to take some time to recognize how much the world has changed. Look at Gen Z, and when it comes to issues of race, we're actually soon to the point where the majority of people will be minority. So we live in a minority-majority world. We think a better name for the nuns is the unaffiliated, just people who aren't affiliated or aren't connected. But the nuns are the none of the aboves. People don't have any religion. When they answer a question, they don't say Christian or Jewish or Hindu. There's none or nothing. So in Gen Z, in 2020, Gen Z are 45% nuns. 45% nuns. It's pretty stunning. 7% atheists, 6% agnostics, 31% nothing in particular, and 35% Christian. So pretty fascinating how big the shift is before us. Actually, you can actually look at the nuns who think the Christian faith is harmful to society is actually, you might find, is not as high as you might expect. So only among atheistic nuns, only 43% think it's harmful to society. Among agnostic nuns, 21%. But the vast majority, only 3% of people think that. But I think we're at a season when we look at these numbers and we could say, I'm not sure how to engage this generation. And what I would say is, I'll talk some about this in the Q&A, is just beginning the relationship is going to be key. Help equipping Christian young adults to engage in those contexts as well. But I want you to take a look at this as kind of my last slide. This is actually receptivity. We asked the nuns, these are not all Americans, these are the nuns. If a friend of mine really values their faith, I don't mind them talking about it. If a friend of mine, and again, show them the next slide too. I asked, which of the following would make you more interested in listening to what Christians had to say? There are things and there are ways we can be as followers of Jesus that help people to have a greater hearing and a greater openness to the gospel. I saw them treat others because of their faith. I saw them caring for people's needs because of their faith. And I don't know about you, but in the last few years, I've seen all kinds of Christians do all kinds of these things. Some more than I've seen them ever before. The front third has stepped up. And so if the world's in the midst of this tumult and turbulence, go ahead and go back to the slide about receptivity. And we actually have 75% agree, somewhat or strongly, that if a friend of mine really values their faith, I don't mind them talking about it. If we're going to engage in the good news of the gospel in the next few years, remember I said pointing people to Jesus, and that's part of what we're doing, the He Gets Us campaign. So you got hundreds of millions of dollars so that people are talking about Jesus all over the country. But then you've got tens of millions of Christians who, if they've been changed by the power of the gospel and living out its truths, are the kind of people that we want to be representing Jesus and His kingdom in the midst of a broken and hurting world. And the nuns themselves, nuns, none of the above, people who have no religious identification or affiliation, they say, I don't mind people sharing my faith. Now, here's the reality. I think we're talking ourselves out of evangelizing an entire generation because we aren't listening to the fact that they're actually open to hear the good news of the gospel.
What does the harvest or conversion look like for the nuns?
A harvest or conversion look like for nuns? Yeah, that's a good question. I think ultimately one of the things we have to recognize is the process of conversion is elongated for people who are farther from religious faith and practice. Now, again, I believe in, again, I'm going to get very technical here. I teach this at the graduate level. So I believe in punctiliar conversion. So punctiliar conversion is the idea, and it's a uniquely evangelical idea. It's not probably the way people taught as 1,000 years ago, but it's the idea that on Tuesday morning, I was dead in my trespasses and sins, as Paul writes in Ephesians, and I've received Tuesday night by grace and through faith, and in a moment in time, I have been converted, and now I'm a follower of Jesus. So I believe in punctiliar conversion, punctiliar point in time conversion, new life in Christ. So that's really important to me. I would say that what's interesting is, for me, punctiliar conversion happened in probably 2 days. I knew enough about religion because, you know, I went through First Communion. I don't think I got to confirmation, so I had some religious background. And when someone said to me, "This is what the Bible says," and I was a young boy, and my life was a mess, as every maybe young boys is at that time. And so I was just ready, man. So I on August 13th, 1977, I was born again by the power of the gospel. So I still believe people at a moment in time are born again by the power of the gospel. I think what's different is my 2 days of hearing the gospel and becoming a follower of Jesus is much less common in 2022 than it was in 1977 when I became a follower of Jesus. So I think what we're more likely seeing is what I call waves of reconsideration or correction. So, and there's a journey, there's an evangelism journey. So the first thing might be, okay, there's a God. And most people, 81% of people think there's a God right now in America. But then the next thing might be, you know, there's a God and he's active. That's a different thing. You know, a whole lot of people I know believe there's a God, like a divine, you know, clockmaker, watchmaker, and he's sort of out there, they're functional deists. But then there's a God and he sent his son. So that might take me a while to get there and to believe that. You know, if I'm sharing the gospel with a Muslim, I mean, the idea that God has a son is stunning. So each of these things is a reconsideration or a clarification. And in missiology, you have what's called the angle scale. So people start at maybe -8 and -7, -6, -5, and people are starting a lot further back and coming closer and closer. So what it looks like today is probably a longer conversation, probably a conversation in community. Let your church be a place that people who don't know the Lord can come and hear and consider. You can tell them that, you know, Christians are teaching Christians and not everything applies to non-Christians in this setting, but have them be able to hear what it's like to be a Christian, and then they'll be connected to some degree to their community. They're not a member of the church. I believe in what we call regenerate church membership in my denominational tradition, so you have to be a follower of Christ. So I think in community, an elongated conversation is more what evangelism looks like in 2022.
So, Ed, I'd like to spend the last few minutes that we have together turning toward questions related to kind of real practical things about doing evangelism. One of the questions that was raised was about the role of hospitality.
Yeah.
We talked about relationship, but could you expand a little bit upon how hospitality built on those relationships can help us in terms of sharing the gospel?
Yeah, for sure. Can you fire back up that PowerPoint while we're talking? Because that was actually where I was headed, and I'll just throw up a couple of slides. John Dixon. Some of you know John Dixon. How many of you know who John Dixon is or read some of his stuff? Anybody? Okay, good. Good. But John, in his book, Bullies and Saints, talks about one of the things that we can do is to engage people kind of where they are a little bit differently. And this might be where some of this relational comes in, is to ask some questions, affirm some things about what people are. Think about the way that Paul does this at the Areopagus. I see that in many ways you're very religious. Even admit, and what John says, John was on this national television program in Australia, and they were talking about all the bad things that Christians did, and John said, oh, those are so true. I've actually could tell you some more bad things, too. Because there have been bad things. Says, but at the same time, Christians invented the hospital. At the same time, we speak of women in a very different way, in part because of Jesus treated and Christians have seen women in the image of God worthy of dignity and respect and more. And so I think that's helpful. Go one more slide, one more advanced, and I think it gets this. And so part of it too is to do so in hospitality. If you'll notice here, is we belong to the broader community. Now, belonging doesn't mean, and again, it doesn't mean membership. It doesn't mean, I mean, there is a covenant community that is the church, people who are born again, holding each other accountable and more. But if you'll notice it's to belong to the broader community, bless the world to reach, bring to the community the church, and build a beloved community through hospitality, which gets back to what you're saying. So hospitality and being shockingly hospitable, radically hospitable to people who deeply disagree, I think becomes a disarming part of a conversation and gives us the opportunity to show and share the love of Jesus in very powerful ways. Yeah, I believe. So again, the whole missional conversation, I think, and again, this is all in Rick's book and in our research project, so you can check it out at You Found Me.